Palau is actually located about 7 degrees north of the equator. Pacific region, we have three regions. You have Polynesia, Melanesia, and Micronesia. And Palau is located inside Micronesia. Micro meaning small, Nesia meaning islands. So we're small islands, that's our sub-region. It's always summertime around throughout the year, 365 days. And Palau is roughly about 108 square miles altogether, mainly made up of three sections on the island. Babadab, which is the biggest island, the other region, which is Koror, which is where we're at right now. And then you have what you call Yoldab. Yoldab consists of Peleliu, Angar, Tobi, Sansoro. Babadab also includes Kayang, by the way. And in all, where our population is roughly about 18 to 19,000. There's two official languages. We have English and we have Palawan. And there's a third one. It's called Polish. It's a combination of both. Sometimes now you hear Palawan, we're speaking Palawan, then all of a sudden they change it to English. That's Polish. We are a matrilineal society. What I mean by that is traditionally, to become a chief, your ranking in the clan, to own land, is all through your mother's side. And so when you ask me where I'm from here in Palau, I'm from Maligao. Why? That's my mom's village. There are 16 states in Palau. These states were actually villages back then. They were districts. And so when Palau became independent in 1994, these 16 municipalities back then became states. So there are 16 states now in Palau. Marimlungui, Aimaliga, Malagao, Koror. Those are the four highest traditional ranking states in Palau. So I'm from one of them, Aimaliga. Aimaliga is actually on the east coast of Babadab. And also, if you ever into Palau, you go to our new capitol building, you're actually in Maligao already. The Bai, men's meeting house. A Bai is a men's meeting house where they actually the chiefs of that one particular village or that one state get together, the top 10. And they talk about things. In the old days, they talk about communal things. That's the one place where the chiefs would get together and discuss either going to war, what was the village, or trying to manage a resource, or try to prevent some sort of a natural disaster, or prevent village from going to starvation. That's the culture that we need to revive, to me in Palau. We need to kind of find people to sit down and actually really listen. And then learn, and then it's part of their culture for life. You know, when they die, at least they can pass it on to the next generation. Palau, amazingly, we have our own endemic species, the flora and fauna. We have roughly about 13 endemic birds in Palau. Especially if you go to the Rock Islands, you see this white orchid that can only be found on the Rock Islands in Palau. Topography is actually made up of mangroves. You start from the reef. Flat, and then you come to the seagrass bed, and you come to the mangroves. It's called a savanna, and the savanna is kind of an open field prairie. And then from the savannas, you go up to the forest. And one of the tools that they would often use is called the bull, B-U-L. And bull is basically a tool that allows Mother Nature to recover. And so you have the women on one side who actually appoint chiefs, but then you have the traditional leaders on one side that actually manage the resources. And they keep law and order in the community. That's part of the culture.
My name is Tokie Suzuki. I'm originally from Iwa State, island of Republic of Palau. Palau is mainly matriarchal society. The women choose the chiefs and the chiefs do the work for the clan. So mainly the man is the one earning the money and the woman takes care of the children and the house. So growing up in this type of society, we knew our responsibility as women and we know what the responsibility is for men. And so we show that to our children to tell them that you have a voice, so you don't just let the men make all that decisions, and you get up and you have that ability to go and do what's necessary to make that change for the country. Baby shower is only for the first birth of the child. I'm married with two children. When I had my first birth, my family would be providing food and my husband's family would be providing money. It would be a lot of preparation of food and tents and even a band. And so when the woman comes out with ginger oil all covered up, it would shine. The woman is meant to come out with breast exposed and the skirt and the belt in the middle of belly button. It exposes to show that the woman is able to take care of the child and be a good mother and wife for the husband. I would be presented in front of my husband's tent so they can take a whole look at me and approve or disapprove. It's basically for them to see, am I gonna be a good mother? Are my breasts big enough to support the milk for the child? Or in the olden days, that's how they look at the body shape, would not necessarily be like a model these days, but to support the baby that's going.
So by going to this omangat, or the childbirth ceremony, when you see that baby, you basically have made a promise to all the family members that that baby is not only yours, but it belongs to the entire family. And that's the community. It takes a community to raise a child. And that's where it begins. That's the foundation. And that's the essence of one of Palau's culture. It takes a community to raise a child.
Most places we go to are these areas by the water. We just hang out for a day or a couple of days. You never really appreciate Rock Islands until you get a perspective of an outsider. They see it and they're just floored with the beauty of the ocean and the watercolor, and we're like, yeah, that's normal. But to see that perspective gets us to appreciate it more because we grew up with it. So we see it every day or every weekend. And most families would have visited all the Rock Islands throughout their lives. So when we speak of Ngarmeaus, Ngarumthiu, all these different types of Rock Islands, everybody has an idea of their location and what are their particular things there that we enjoy.
初めてロックアイランド見た時はとにかく驚きましたね。ここが海だっていうことに。パラオの島、いわゆるロックアイランドっていうのは日本の島とは全然違う 形なんですよ。ロックアイランドの中を最初にボートで駆け抜けていくときにね、海面のその静けさ、島の雰囲気っていうものが、ここが本当に島なのかって思うくらい衝撃が強い景色でしたね。印象的でした。もともとそのダイビングが好きで海に潜りたくて、できるだけこうたくさん潜れるためにはどうしたらいいんだろうっていうふうに思って、考えた末に一番手っ取り早いのはそれを仕事にすることだなと思って、パラオに。パラオのダイビングポイントというのはものすごくバリエーションが豊富なエリアというのかな、パラオ自体が非常に豊富なバリエーションの豊富な海だと僕は思っていまして、バリアリーフに囲まれた内海とその外側のアウトサイドリーフ、特にやっぱりすごいなと思うのは外海のそのダイナミックさ。パラオの北の方は北赤道海流で、南の方は赤道反流の影響を強く受けていると僕は思っていまして、でその海流の影響を強く受けているせいなのか、非常に流れがかかるということはプランクトンもよく移動することになりますのでね、魚が栄養豊富な海の中で生活をすることができる、必然餌がたくさんあるので魚の数も増えてくるということで、とにかくその魚の種類もそして魚の数が多いっていうのがね、このダイブサイトのやっぱり僕はすごいところなんじゃないのかなっていうのは潜るたびにやっぱ感じるところですね。印象的なダイビングっていうのはいくつもあるんですけれども、ジャーマンチャネルのマンタの捕食のシーンっていうのはその中の一つと言えるかなと思います。毎年秋口になるとマンタが繁殖のためにジャーマンチャネルというポイントに集まってきます。でその時のそのマンタたちっていうのは自分のパートナーを見つけたいので一つの大きな群れを作って泳ぐことが多いんです。壮大で、このパラオの海の力強さっていうものを象徴する僕はシーンだなといつも思うんです。なのでその月回りにあったタイミングでいらっしゃったお客様はね、できるだけそこにご案内をして、その感動を共有するようにさせてもらってます。非常に僕にとっても印象深いダイビングです。
Ali from the island of Palau. This is your captain speaking. Lend me your ears.
Director General of the World Health Organization, Dr. Ted Ross, has declared that March 2020 outbreak of the new coronavirus is a pandemic. The number of people infected worldwide is increasing at an accelerating and has reached more than 100 countries and territories, indicating that early containment is unlikely.
I think globally nobody knew what the pandemic would look like in 3 months. Tourism is our number one economy, and so we were heavily depending on it. And before the pandemic, Tourism actually, at one study, it actually provided close to 60% of our island economy. But the number one thing was safety. And so when Palau officially went to a lockdown in April of last year, I hate to say this, but to me, it became Palau again. But one thing when we did a lockdown, it was just not the airport. Restaurants closed. Hotels closed. Stores had limited hours. We had what you call a curfew in Koror. People could not be walking the streets after 9 o'clock at night. The confirmed bookings ended up canceled. People will lose jobs. People's income will decrease. Families will have to become more resourceful in other ways. Tour operators, tour guides, people who worked in the hospitality industry, they became fishermen, full-time fishermen. People also were looking for a part-time job, whatever job they could get, you know, to supplement their income. It also, because we were so dependent on foreign workers in the tourism industry, so when the pandemic hit, we had a lot of these foreign workers, they couldn't go anywhere. So we had to work with our bilateral partners like the Philippines and so forth, and they had to charter flights to bring these people back. And so as the world panicked, Palau also panicked.
まだパラオにはコロナに罹患をしている人は一人もいませんので、街中でも外を歩いている人でマスクをしている人はほとんどいません。いくつかの施設には入るときにマスクをしたりしている人もいますけれども、やっぱりそういう意味では世界から比べてみるとまだまだ安全度レベルというのは高いのかなというふうに思います。飛行機が止まるっていうふうに聞いたときは正直こんなに長くなるとは思ってなかったんですよ。だからそうかと、数ヶ月したらまた元に戻るんじゃないのかなというイメージでしたね。だからその時自体はあんまり深刻に、いやもちろん状況としては深刻なんだけれども、今よりも深刻には考えてなかったかなというイメージですね。基本的にはやっぱりお客様がいらっしゃらないので、収入がどの会社もない。これはビジネスを運営していく上で最もというか唯一にして最大のインパクトかなというふうに思います。それでも施設であったりとか維持していかないといけないので、そういう支出はね、出続けていってるので、やっぱり長くなれば長くなるほどこのダメージっていうのはインパクトは大きくなっていくと思います。僕だけじゃなくて、パラオ中の、もちろん多分世界中のね、観光業 の, ビジネスをされている方、皆さんやっぱり同じように耐えてらっしゃると思います。たくさんの時間が手に入るようになりましたね。でこれはいいことなのか悪いことなのか自分でもよくわからないんですけれども、今まで20数年間そのお客様たちと向き合う仕事をずっとやってきて、毎日人と会うことがもう当たり前、そういう生活をしてきたんですけれども、このパンデミックになって飛行機が飛んでこなくなってね、お客様が来れなくなって、結果一人でいる時間がものすごく多くなりましたね。人に会わないということがこんなにつまらないものだっていうのを本当に改めて骨身に染みたこの1年かなと思います。
How's our plan?
Today we have a loading for cargo to charter of government of Southwest at Hatobi Island. Then tomorrow we depart at 9 a.m. and then we arrive at Hatobi Island May 17, 6 a.m. in the morning.
今はお客様がいらっしゃらないので、 まあ、通常の、まあ、いわゆるそのダイブクルーズというのはできていません。なんですけれども、2012年からずっと続けているパラオの南西諸島、ハトホーベイ州とあのソンソロール州の州政府に対して、島の人や物資を運ぶお手伝いですね、今年はあの丸々スケジュールが空いているので、まあ、州政府の方からまあ積極的に使いたいということで、結構な頻度でフェリーボートのお仕事をいただいてます。とても不思議な感覚で今パラオの海を見てます。っていうのは、今まではずっと徐々にやっぱり人間が潜ってるインパクトを受けて環境が傷んでいくのをずっと見てきました。でここでその今パンデミックになって人が潜らないようになって環境が戻っていってるという現実を目の当たりにして、個人としては非常に驚きながら喜ばしいことだと思ってます。で、そういった状況をこう目の当たりに改めてね、あの今までも頭では分かってました。だけどそれを改めて目の当たりにすることによって、この先ね、その自分たちがダイビングガイドとしてどうやってお客様たちを案内しなければいけないか、でそうすることによってここがこの海がどういうふうに維持され同じ状態に近いまま、あの将来へつないでいってあげることができるのかっていうのを、おそらく今パラオに残ってるあのガイドの人たちはみんな同じようなことを学んでると思います。うん、個人的にもだからすごくいい経験ができたと思ってますし、これをやっぱり忘れてはいけないと僕はすごく思います。個人的にはどこからか始めないと多分始まらないと思っていたので、そういう意味では非常にいいきっかけにはなったのかなと思ってます。今はねパラオと台湾だけで、やっていますけれども、これもまたあのもちろんね、新しいことを始めるっていうことは賛否両論あって、でいいことばかりではないし、反対する人もたくさんいるとは思うんですけれども、さっきも言ったみたいに何かを始めないと何も始まらないことを考えると、これは僕はすごくいい試みだったんだろうと思ってますし、僕個人的には評価してます。
The bubble, I think it was great that the naval doctors came, because then it gave a lot of the people a bit more hope, not panicking about COVID-19, and there are things we could do. I mean, we can't just sit and wait. We have to be looking at solutions and ways on how to get to be opened again and having some type of business slowly. It doesn't have to be a lot.It can be a slow, so we can all be comfortable about this. Because I think there's still some concern, which is fine. Everybody should be open about what they feel. But to do it slowly, I think it's the best plan. So everybody just kind of slowly gets comfortable to doing it, rather than too much and then it dies and doesn't work out. So.Yeah, I think this is a great way to start the bubble. And hopefully there's going to be another country.
観光業はね、多分なくならないと思います。人間が新しいものを見てみたいという冒険欲求がなくならない限り、僕は観光業はなくならないと思うんですね。で、どんなに今バーチャルが発達をしてきて、今いろんなね、あの番組なんかもありますけれども、でもその人間がやっぱり求めるそのリアルっていうものは、おそらくそのリアルへの欲求っていうのかな、多分僕はなくならないと思うんですよ。なので数は減るのかもしれないし、形は変わるのかもしれないけれど、観光業、要するにその場所に行ってお客さんたちがその体感をする、リアルを楽しむっていうことは僕はなくならない気がします。なのでそういった意味では時代に合わせた観光業っていうのが多分僕はできるんじゃないのかなと思いますし、そういうふうに僕ら観光業事業者も変わっていく、かっこよければ進化していく、 ことは必要なのかもしれませんけど、継続はすると思います、うん、発展していくんじゃないでしょうか。発展していきたいですね。お客様が来なくなって自分自身がね、人を喜ばせるということが本当に好きな人間だったんだなということに改めて気がついたんですよ。で、やっぱりそこが分かってしまうと、そこに自分自身で気づいてしまうと、やっぱりまだ諦めたくないよね、うん、もう一回やりたいな、もう一回お客さんたちを喜ばせたいな、迎え入れたいなって思っているかな。だからそういう意味ではそこが今僕の中での希望であり理想であり、そこに向かって、うん、だからまあ耐えてる、そんな感じです。
I hope everything will be back to normal just like before.
Sana matapos na ang pandemic para makauwi na ako sa Pilipinas.
I hope that mawala na yung pandemic, yung virus dito sa mundo.
Hayaku suki na toki ni suki na tokoro e ikitai desu.
My hope is anything can happen as long as you believe.
Palau è ciò che potrebbe essere. La mia speranza, my hope is, è quello che una nuova partenza.
Ang Palau para sa akin ay aking pangalawang tahanan kasi nandito ang side street na aking pangalawang pamilya.
Hope for me is to believe that anything is possible and as long as you believe, anything can happen.
Love and peace!
ここを通じてパラオと日本両国の今後の交流と発展に貢献したいです。
Really, really, I hope never become change the, you know, in the ocean. That's why we living here, we love in Palau.
We hope the pandemic finish very soon.
点赞。
What Palau teach us?
Relax, don't rush.
So, people ask, what does Bruno do for you? That's the million-dollar question, and I'll give you the $5 response. It's like sex without attachment. Meaning, you know, when you chew Bruno, it gives you that burst of energy, and then when you're done, you're done. Unlike sex is when you finish that burst of energy, you still have to cuddle, hold, take her home. Bruno, no.It's sex-free, but it gives you that burst of energy.